southern Europe, beneath the shadow of crumbling castles, stretching off toward the east, where centuries ago rapacious hordes and waves swept through to conquer, where cauldrons still boil from the quenchless heat of primitive human passions, it's easy to believe most end tale. I heard the vampire legend in the little village of Fortempierre, from the lips of a horrified eyewitness. Christ may have steered his once clear, cultured mind, but I know he was honest and thought every word he uttered the truth. Smarter men than I believe these incredible stories. Listen.
I didn't believe the master when my teaching days were over. Some strange power kept me there, even though the days and nights were filled with fear. Perhaps it was this same strange power that called the young man from the faraway city on that lovely day in June. It wasn't the same as when the master with the daughter were my daily pupils. There was no inn in the castle park then, just the lovely home of wealth and dignity. It was before the horror came. It was before everyone and everything seemed touched by some cold, clammy hand from a chilling, moldy grave. Came our way, did the death spell fall on them as it was always present in me? Did this man see it in the faces of those simple folk around him? Did he sense at once the fear in which all of us were gripped? Did the horror we knew so well follow him through the drear dark halls to the cheerless room he sought? Did he feel its presence in the shadowed corner? To us, that nameless horror was much too real to be dispelled by the light of mere spluttering candles.
Good night.
Good night.
There was a human death's head outside his window. Drawn shades could shut that out, but not all the signs of that mysterious disaster which had followed the master's family for years. Why paint grief and anguish? But could the gentle ladies who lived in this place of gloom find inspiration for anything else? Tragedy and tears were their eternal heritage, compelling forces that colored their every expression. I saw the young man come to our dreary, stricken home that day in June. I learned to know him well, for was it not he that helped me rid my master and my little missus of the curse? He told me how the master came to him at night, as though he walked in a trance, like a man beside himself. My poor dear master. Once more, he sensed impending doom. He was mad from grief.
Who are you?
Thank you.
But if this strange young man will not return for the help he might have had from me, did he think this poor mind of mine no longer worked? Did he think these aging arms too weak to drive just one more iron stake? Seeing his precious flowers fade. There was no security for those he loved, and no peace for him. The blows that fell, the blows his watchful eyes could not prevent. They were struck by vengeful hands from another world.
The wounds are almost healed.
Night in any quiet countryside, to unaccustomed ears, is a time of eerie sounds. The hoot of a harmless owl can be a foreboding thing. The voice of a frightened child may shriek in the chirp of a happy cricket. Beauty doesn't die from neglect. It only changes form. The lakes and moats of Cotentiere will never lose their charm as long as the moon looks down. Mere decay isn't sinister. It was that deepening grave that night. Those furtive humans, so strangely busy in the midst of this decay, that drew young Alan closer to the horror which all of us have felt for years. The peg-legged soldier with a gun, slow and silent in these crumbling ruins. No less terrifying were the signs of what the humans did there. Ghosts and spirits don't work earthly tools. They don't build coffins. And strange indeed are those in the netherworld so careful of the preservation of human flesh. Man's original sin was curiosity. The fruit of just one tree in the Garden of Eden was denied him, and that one tree was the tree of life. Here at Crottempierre, as everywhere since the days of unhappy Adam, disaster was the price of disobedient meddling with this same mystery of life. Black magic's evil incantations will never pierce the veil so tightly drawn between the living and the dead. This veil will always remain the bulwark of comforting human faith.
Hold
happening? A stone goblin.
Quick, they're killing him.
Thing, fighting back in desperation with the years of effort the master has spent in finding out what to do to save all of us from this sinister power. It was a young man who sent for the police. It was good to have him there. Even I felt that through him our salvation had come. He was young and determined. From an outside world where there is no curse or decay. His ale clung to him, but he knew, as I did, that our help could not come from the law. The master had known that too. The whispered tales of Coton Pierre posed a problem no mere gendarme could solve. To the police.
Hello?
story the master had written in that journal, that old inanimate thing to which we're frightened and alone, he had poured his heart for years. I too had felt the woe that overpowered him. I too had seen the curse at work throughout our pretty countryside. Slow, insidious, creeping death, but none could understand. Lerne was wasting away in the castle. Was dear to me as to him. I too had longed to her childish laughter. My heart too was breaking at her bitter, hopeless despair. Could hear, and none of us
quick,
could walk.
Thank you.
birthday. Work with the same dear mother's work. Happy together in their childhood play. Sharing each other's treasures. Loving each other through the years with touching devotion until the curse of Saint-Pierre struck. Now one fired with bloodlust under the vampire's will, hovering on the brink of an earthly grave, from which she, like her cruel mistress, were destined to roam in restless search for the precious life stream of which she had been robbed. The other gentle girl, bewildered at this monstrous change, cowering, cringing always, more at the panic that fought for Saturn. You've been very patient with my rambling, sir. You say you've heard the vampire tale before. You say you can't believe it. Perhaps. But what happened here at Courtanpierre, and it was not so long ago, burned into my very soul. And it must have been the white hot iron of truth. And we sent for the police, came back, but I found him dead on his carriage seat. He too was my lifelong friend. Another bullet. Mr. Pooch, it's hard to see fresh, warm, dripping human blood. Surpassing cunning. Blows were falling fast. The master's journal and the young man, free of her power, had numbered this demon's days.
Never cease thanking God for the courage of that young stranger who has happened into our midst. Our troubles were not his. He had an easy means of escape, and surely he saw enough horror in his first few hours to justify his taking it.
No, very bad.
Halt.
Wait.
Perhaps the evil that shone from our old doctor's every to fight back. More likely it was pity for Leonie as he saw her there dying for lack of the precious blood the vampire had sucked from her veins.
Can't she be saved?
Perhaps. But she needs blood. And, of course, human blood. You want to give her some of your blood? Come, young man. We must give her some of your blood.
Certainly none but a hero, as real as the ones in shiny armor, that stalked these same castle walls in their earlier days of glory, would have bared his arm to this foul servant's touch, even for beauty in distress.
Go to sleep.
Huh? You hear me?
In the years of the past, I have often wondered why my dear dead master didn't confide in me. I was not under the vampire's power. Maybe he didn't know. His trust had been all too often betrayed. If he'd only told me what he told his precious journal, it was not too much for even me. Old as I was, to save Leonie from suicide, and I could have stopped the vampire's hideous crimes long, long before, had I only known how. The young man told me afterwards of his hideous dream. It was not unlike the real life happening of his first night at the castle. There were coffins and ghastly trappings in both. But the coffin in the dream was for him, not for the once fresh young girl, the evil Margaret Chopin had marked for her own. He saw, he told me, every detail of his passing into the great beyond. Every cruel machination of the vampire's crew at work.
Thank you.
ghastly triumph won, he saw his coffin closed. Frightful journey to the grave.
Doctor.
What's the matter?
I'm losing blood.
Nonsense. Your blood's right here.
They say there is constant conflict between the forces of good and evil. Man is not left to fight alone, and the Prince of Darkness battles. It must have been a helpful voice from this same spirit world that told me, as I read the Master's journal, that another tragedy threatened, that there was no time to lose.
Quick!
Sister, don't let her die. She must live till sunrise.
Margaret Chopin never struck again. God had given me strength for one last service I could render to those I loved. For me, there was no terror in the vampire's reeking grave. God's will was done on those who had accepted her wicked dominion. They died with her, as they had lived through her. When cold steel pinned her heart to the sacred ground she had so long defiled, peace came to Fortnite, I know. There must have been a vampire.
Open the door! Please! Don't you hear? Please!